Welcome to this African Caribbean Institute of Jamaica, Jamaica Memory Bank, CSEC History Lecture. Our topic for today will be Caribbean society, and we'll be focusing specifically on Jamaican religious groups. If we look on our CSEC syllabus, we'll see that there are specific objectives for this theme. Students should be able to describe the social and economic conditions existing in the Caribbean between 1900 and 1935. Outline efforts made to improve social conditions by different agents. Describe various aspects of social life. Explain the reasons for the emergence of various religious groups in the Caribbean. And assess the implications of membership in the various groups. The syllabus breaks down the content into five areas. Under social and economic conditions, you'll be expected to talk about housing, cost of living, working conditions, unemployment, and health. Secondly, you'll be looking at the organizations that were working towards improving conditions. These organizations included trade unions, governments, women's organizations, and the United Negro Improvement Association, founded by Marcus Garvey. Next, you'll look on various aspects of social life. These include ethnic and race relations, festivals and celebrations, recreation, transport and communication, and art forms. The next area of content that the syllabus requires us to look on are the different religious groups that have played a role in Caribbean society. These include Christian, Hindu, and Muslim groups, as well as African Christian syncretic religions and indigenous religions such as Rastafari. Finally, we are asked to examine the implications of membership in these groups. Essentially, what were the social, economic, and political consequences that came with belonging to one of these groups? So let's jump right in. I'd like us to start by taking a look at what the Caribbean actually looked like at the time. Here we have rare video footage of Jamaica shot in 1913. Pay attention to how this can help you to satisfy the first objective, describing the social and economic conditions of the Caribbean in the early 20th century. Think too about what it says on aspects of social life. What are the modes of transport and communication that you can see in the video? What are the different architectural features that you observe? Here are some workers chopping logwood. What do you think a day's work was like for them? Imagine too what life was like for the majority of Jamaicans living in rural areas. In the century after slavery ended, how had life changed? At the moment of emancipation, the freed people would have had many hopes and aspirations. They would have hoped to have been able to move about freely, to reconstitute and consolidate their families, to earn fair wages, to have access to their provision grounds, and ultimately to have control over their lives. For many, control meant continuing to farm their provision grounds while working on the plantations for wages when necessary to supplement their incomes. However, poor treatment by the planters pushed many of the former enslaved to seek their own plots of land. This led to the development of a peasantry in a number of Caribbean territories by the beginning of the 20th century. By 1902, in Jamaica, for instance, there were over 24,000 peasants owning lands between 5 and 50 acres in size. And peasant farmers in the island accounted for the majority of coffee exported by the beginning of the 20th century. In Trinidad, peasant farmers played a very important role in the cocoa industry, which was an important part of their economy. Peasants also introduced crops that later became major export staples in the plantation economy, such as bananas. The Indian peasantry in British Guiana and Trinidad contributed significantly to rice production, which supplied the domestic economy. However, for many in the rural areas, plantation work remained an important source of employment. Many peasants also supplemented their cash income in jobs that public works offered. There was work on roads, the railway, and the construction of bridges. All of these attracted a rural labor force, but wages were poor, and the majority lived in poverty with poor housing and health conditions. There were developments in the urban areas, with improvements especially in transport and communications, and many persons flocked from rural areas in search of jobs in these sectors. Some persons found work as artisans, working as blacksmiths, coopers, masons, and carpenters. Many persons also made a living selling crops, craft, and other items in the markets in these towns. But again, the majority earned low incomes and lived in poor conditions in depressed communities. To give you an idea of what wages were like, in the early 20th century in Jamaica, a man's day pay as an ordinary laborer could be as low as 1 shilling. Women were even worse off, being paid 6 pence. The government offered 1 shilling per day for road work. Planters normally paid 1 shilling and 3 pence for a whole day of field or estate work. Wages were only slightly better for artisans and for members of the lower middle class. First-class carpenters and masons received 4 shillings for a day's work. A tailor could earn 10 shillings for a suit, while a shoemaker could receive 4 shillings for repairing the soles of a pair of shoes, the same for a dressmaker sewing a dress. A second-class constable's pay was 2 shillings and 4 pence per day. Even so, they would have only been able to afford the very basic necessities. Some members of the working classes and peasantry were able to attain a degree of upward social mobility through education. However, as historian Patrick Bryan warns, we should be careful not to exaggerate the importance of elementary education as a factor in social mobility, insofar as elementary education in itself was unable to provide that. And it was unable to provide it because that was never the intention. The intention instead was to prepare a passive workforce of obedient servants and laborers. The white authorities, with their racial biases, never saw Caribbean Indians and blacks as being fit for much more than manual labor, and therefore they emphasized agricultural and technical training. The majority of elementary education comprised the 3 R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic, with a heavy dose of religion, Christian instruction, thrown in. An elementary education, however, did provide an opening for further education, especially for those who excelled and were able to move on to training colleges, and in a few cases to study overseas. A few Caribbean blacks and Indians were able to take advantage of these opportunities, and the result was the growth of an educated professional class. Black women were amongst the group who benefited from greater educational facilities. These women filled jobs requiring skills in shorthand, typing, and telegraph operation. Some also became nurses and teachers. Nevertheless, in most territories, even though it was evident that non-whites were making great social advances through education, the racial factor was ever present, so they often had to be contented with continued subservience to white individuals competing in the same position, even though in many cases those whites were not qualified. This was even evident in the Jamaican cricket team, which remained all white until the beginning of the 20th century. Right across the Caribbean then, in the early 20th century, non-whites were mostly disenfranchised, unrepresented, and subjugated physically and mentally by ruling white imperial ideologies. These conditions gave rise to a number of movements for change. A number of black nationalists and Pan-Africanists came to the fore, like Dr. Robert Love, a Bahamian who lived in Jamaica, and Henry Sylvester Williams of Trinidad. These men were the forerunners of probably the most important Caribbean Pan-Africanist of the early 20th century, Marcus Mosiah Garvey. Garvey's life and works from 1914 to 1927 were dominated by his involvement in the Universal Negro Improvement Association, which was founded in Jamaica in 1914. With the UNIA, Garvey was to create the greatest and largest Pan-African organization of all time. At its peak, there were UNIA branches in Cuba, Trinidad, Jamaica, British Guiana, the Dominican Republic, Barbados, Belize, the Bahamas, Antigua, Bermuda, Dominica, Suriname, Grenada, Haiti, Nevis, Puerto Rico, St. Kitts, St. Lucia, St. Thomas, and St. Vincent. Meanwhile, sections of the disadvantaged masses carried out more radical action. The early response of the working class to their low wages and bad working conditions was work stoppages or strikes. This sometimes included the sabotage of estate equipment and fields, as well as the occasional riot. In general, however, these actions were spontaneous, unorganized, and ineffective. There were some tentative attempts to form trade unions in the two decades leading up to World War I, and this saw the rise of trade union leaders across the Caribbean like Arthur Cipriani of Trinidad, who revived the Trinidad Working Men's Association in 1919 and secured for dock workers a number of improvements in working conditions like an 8-hour workday, a workmen's compensation law, and the establishment of an agricultural bank. Uriah Buzz Butler in Trinidad, Hubert Critchlow in British Guiana, and Clement Paine in Barbados were some of the other important labor leaders at this time. As conditions worsened during the Great Depression of the 1930s, there were an increasing number of riots and demonstrations across the British Caribbean. These disturbances culminated with the 1938 outbreak at Froome in Westmoreland, Jamaica. So significant were these outbreaks that the British government sent out a commission the following year to investigate and make recommendations to improve the conditions of the mass of British Caribbean people. Understanding the general socio-economic conditions in the Caribbean in the early 1900s helps us to make sense of the role that religion played. As the religion of the colonizers, Christianity would have been in a dominant place in Caribbean societies. In the British territories, the Anglican Church would have been the church of the elite, and in the Spanish and French territories, this role would have been played by the Roman Catholic Church. The first attempts to take Christianity to the enslaved people began in the mid to late 1700s, when nonconformist missionaries from Britain, such as the Baptists, Moravians, and Methodists, set up churches in the Caribbean for the first time. Of course, West and Central Africans brought with them their own religious practices. And even though these were varied, they shared certain commonalities. Are you familiar with the popular culture classic film, The Harder They Come, starring Jimmy Cliff? Listen for a minute to the words of the song. What is the message that is coming across here? Tell me of the pie up in the sky. Jimmy Cliff referring to when he says they tell him about high up in the sky? And what is his reaction to the idea that heaven awaits him in the afterlife? Do you see similarities when Bob tells us to stand up for our rights? Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right. Get up, stand up. Don't give up. Preacher man, don't tell me heaven is under the earth. I know you don't know what life is really worth. It's a call that Peter is cold. After story had never been told. So now you see the light. Hey, stand up for your right. Come on. What we see here from these two songs is a kind of indication of the differences between the roles played by Christianity and by Afro-Caribbean religions. What we're seeing is a challenge to this kind of idea of a heaven, an afterlife, a paradise that will come when the woes and the suffering of this earth are over. And in the early days of exposure to Christianity by nonconformist missionaries in the latter days of slavery, in the early days of emancipation, there's a kind of great emphasis on this aspect of the Christian message,
that a part of life involves suffering, that, you know, blessed are the meek, blessed are the humble who will inherit the earth, that paradise will come in the afterlife when the suffering of this earth is over. And while there is, you know, an importance to that message, to an importance to the idea of what happens to the soul, an importance to the idea of eternal life and salvation, there's of course also the needs of this world to be dealt with. And one of the things that you will see about Afro-Caribbean religions, religions derived from Western Central African traditions, is that these religions also help adherents to deal with the here and now, to deal with challenges in everyday life. And so, in some ways, you see adherents going both to Christian churches as well as to their own churches based on their African-derived traditions, and the different religious messages serving, you know, sometimes very different roles in their lives. So let's talk a little bit about, you know, West African cosmologies and worldviews, their understanding of God and the spirit world, and how that works in their lives. Of course, there are many differences between the religions, but I'm emphasizing some commonalities for the point of the discussion here. One thing that is evident is that many of these religions are in fact monotheistic. There is the belief in a single supreme deity, a single supreme God. However, what you see in a lot of these religious beliefs is this idea that this supreme God is distant from us here on earth. The supreme God controls not only the earth, but the entire universe. And therefore, we are far away and distant. And instead of communicating directly with the supreme being, it is the spirits that we communicate with on a day-to-day basis, and we ask them for help with the things in our day-to-day lives. So, for instance, you know, you thinking about your economic well-being, you need a job. Think about love and relationships. Think about security.
For all of these day-to-day concerns, believers of Afro-Caribbean religious traditions turn to the spirit world for help. And therefore, what we will notice with a lot of these Western Central African-derived religious traditions is that a lot of the rituals and ceremonies and practices are centered around communication with the spirits. Music, and in particular drumming, is a very important part of the way in which the spirits are summoned or called. Another feature that is evident in a lot of these practices is possession, where practitioners are possessed by the spirits that have been called. Things are also put in place to welcome and to placate the spirits. Thanksgiving tables are set up with various offerings, and sometimes animal sacrifices practiced. Let us now look specifically at some Afro-Jamaican religious traditions.
Revivalism is essentially a syncretic movement combining Christianity and African religious forms. It is Jamaica's main African Christian cult, embracing both Pocomania, or more properly Pocumina, and Revival Zion. Revival Zion, the 60 order, is the most orthodox of contemporary Jamaican cults, and also the most popular found in Jamaica, while Pocomania, the 61 order, is more African than Revival Zion and has less popularity and prestige. The revival religion extends beyond the boundaries of revival churches, yards, and sites to the wider society. People who are not devotees take part in revival rituals and ceremonies because they endorse the belief system. Revival groups are called bands and are organized into three levels. Revivalism expresses the spirituality and ceremony that characterize the religions of the African diaspora. The spirituality rituals, dance, music, music style, and ceremonies are strongly influenced by African religions. Revivalists have three principal types of religious services. These include prayer meetings, street meetings, and rituals for specific purposes. Other services include the baptismal cycle, infant christening, and table ceremonies. Revival bands meet at the mission ground or seal ground. This ground is laid out in a special way, and a flagpole identifies the revival ground and attracts the passing spirits. The seal is the consecrated area of the mission ground and is considered to be the center of all ritual activity. The music and dancing of the congregation attract or call the angels who manifest themselves through the seal. Revivalists would go around the seal three times to get rid of evil spirits. Additionally, water is an important ritual element in revivalism. Glasses, jars, and pools of consecrated water are indispensable and serve as enticements to the spirits. It is believed that the drinking of water during a ceremony is the vehicle through which the spirits gain entrance into the members. Water is used in healing, and it is alleged that famous revivalist Alexander Bedward used consecrated water from the Hope River to cure many sick persons. Revivalists have fostered a network of practice across the island and have established and maintained revival bands in all parishes in Jamaica. These groups come together at revival tables, baptism, healing ceremonies, and the Wat Town celebrations to share in worship. Wat Town is described as the mecca of revivalism. Revivalists visit Wat Town on the first Thursday of every quarter to express themselves through the rituals of revivalism. The spirituality rituals, dance, music styles, and ceremonies are strongly influenced by African religions.
Kumina is an Afro-Jamaican religion centered around a belief system in a supernatural realm that must be frequently placated to ensure harmony in both the corporeal and spiritual worlds. This is achieved through music and dance, animal sacrifice, possession, libations, and sharing of bread with the ancestors and the attendees at the ceremony. The religion was brought to Jamaica by Bantu or Congo laborers from the Angola region of Central Africa, who were brought to the island as indentured workers in the immediate post-emancipation period. A large number of these indentured workers were employed to plantations in the parish of St. Thomas between the 1850s and 1870s. These Africans, like their enslaved predecessors, took with them oral traditions, musical heritage, rituals, and religious beliefs. These retentions formed the basis of the Kumina religion that emerged in the Jamaican space. The practice was mainly associated with the parish of St. Thomas, particularly in communities such as Old Pera, Ginger Hill, Waterfall, Arcadia, Leaf Hall, Seaforth, and Morant Bay. Migrations of Kumina groups saw the spread of the religion into other parishes such as Portland, St. Mary, St. Andrew, Kingston, and St. Catherine.
Kumina is based on the Central African belief in each person possessing a dual soul. The personal spirit, which contains the personality of the individual, and the individual's shadow. On death, the personal spirit goes directly to the all-powerful god Nzambimpungu. These spirits can become ancestral spirits and return to the earth. The shadow remains in the grave with the corpse, but can leave at will. If not given a proper burial, it will become a wandering spirit and a menace not only to the family but to all the people in the area. Kumina ceremonies are always held for specific purposes such as death, births, weddings, thanksgiving, healing, and to remove the wrong kind of spirit from someone afflicted with a spirit sickness. Singing, dancing, and drumming are the three most important elements in a Kumina session, which usually begins at sundown and takes place around a central pole. Dancing and singing are essential as they help to attract the spirits. Animals are also sometimes sacrificed.
Rastafari is not seen as a religion by its members. Rather, they refer to it as a complete way of life. It is a heterogeneous movement, and the beliefs and customs vary amongst the different believers. One aspect of Rastafari, however, is a set of religious beliefs based on the Bible, in particular the Old Testament, as well as the reverence of Haile Selassie I of Ethiopia. Rastafari also involves an Afrocentric worldview and lifestyle, central to which is the idea that Africa, and more specifically Ethiopia, is the home of all black people. Rastafari is also a social movement whose philosophies have largely been developed by and appeal to the oppressed Jamaican masses that are striving for social change. Rastafari emerged in a Jamaica in which the mass of people were subjected to racial and cultural prejudices. Black Jamaicans were told that their skin color was inferior, as were their African-based cultural practices. Rastafari wanted to replace these Eurocentric values, worldviews, and concepts of God with an Afrocentric worldview that had a black God at the center of the cosmos. In doing so, they did not totally reject Christianity and the Bible. Instead, Rastafari reinterpreted the Bible from an Afrocentric perspective and identified with Orthodox Christian traditions that had roots in Africa. The teachings of Alexander Bedward and Marcus Garvey gave the Rastafari movement some of its early direction. The movement grew on both African and Christian religious traditions. This was not surprising since there was a strong revival influence in early Rastafari. Bedward bridged the gap between 19th and 20th century revivalism. He started his ministry in the early 1890s and was a healer in the Jamaican Native Baptist and Revivalist tradition. He preached the ideology of the rise of the black race and set a foundation that Garvey would later build on. Many of the adherents of the Rastafarian worldview were members of the Marcus Garvey movement, which had at its core universal African consciousness and Ethiopia as its symbol of black pride and resilience. Among Garvey's most important messages were his call for black pride, for repatriation, and for blacks to construct a God in their own image. It is also commonly said that Garvey prophesied that blacks should look to Africa where a black king shall be crowned, for the day of deliverance is near. Many people saw the fulfillment of this prophecy in the coronation of Haile Selassie I on 2nd of November 1930, and this was the catalyst that set off the movement. One of the early leaders of the Rastafari movement was Leonard Howell. Some of the things that he thought about were the superiority of the black race, revenge on the wicked, the persecution and humiliation that black Jamaicans suffered at the hands of the Jamaican government, repatriation to Africa, and acknowledgement of Emperor Haile Selassie I as God and the ruler of all black people. Although diverse Rastafari beliefs have emerged over time, there are some commonalities. In general, the divinity of Haile Selassie is recognized. Africa is also recognized as a promised land and a destination for repatriation. For many Rastafari, the Bible is a sacred book and is interpreted literally. Africans were seen as the true chosen people of God and the original Israelites, who had been forcibly deposited into exile in the West, which was referred to as Babylon, that word also coming to refer to all systems of injustice and oppression. Rastafarians argue that only Africans, due to their constant persecution, satisfied the biblical conditions for God's chosen people, and as such, the new movement emphasized the doctrine of black supremacy. So how did belonging to these religions affect members? As you can imagine, these African Christian syncretic religions went against the dominant European-based Christian denominations. Members of the cultural elite were very critical of these African-based religions, and they were classified as inferior and associated with an uncivilized Africa. Members of these religious groups were therefore subjected to a lot of stigma and prejudice. Nonetheless, these Afro-Caribbean religious traditions were very important in terms of preserving African retentions and in celebrating Africanness and blackness. They were an important way in which descendants of Africans in the Caribbean fought against the racial and cultural prejudices of European imperialism.